point my finger and yell at you. And maybe he would be great. I'm not making a political statement. I'm just saying. You've talked about it. Okay, sure. I'm just saying that attitude is uncomfortable for me when someone says how bad someone else is. And it's not just Trump, it's everyone saying, look how bad everything is. Look how bad you are. Look how bad that other person is. That kind of hate journalism, that kind of hate TV, it's just really, how does that lift anyone up? But our society then kind of gets into that, and Facebook gets into it. There are people that I just ignore on Facebook because they're always hating something or someone or some, you know, some big thing. I can't stand that. I want to be encouraging people. Our society is also an entitlement society. Would you agree? I deserve that. I worked hard for it. I don't know what these other people need, but I deserved it. That's why there are so many lawsuits. A doctor makes a mistake. Have you ever made a mistake? Yeah, maybe. And I'm not saying, you know, the doctor makes a mistake and takes out my heart instead of my appendix. I think that's probably big. I think that's probably big. But, you know, just saying, you know, anything happens and we want to just pound on that person rather than say, let's talk about it. Trash talking, blame, we do it all, don't we? Opinion bullies, my opinion is right, yours is wrong. You ever got into that kind of discussion? You ever, at Thanksgiving, are you going to avoid a topic in your families and say, I'm not talking about that because, ooh, Uncle Harry, he gets hot about that. And if you aren't of the same opinion as me, then you are evil, or you are not Christian, or you are not a good enough Christian, or you don't even know who Jesus is, if you are not of the same opinion as me. What if? Just think of it. What if, rather than complaining about what isn't, we encourage someone in what is? What if we did that? Would that make a difference? What if when your child came home and said, I just flunked a test, instead of beating on that child, you know, I'm trying to work for you kids here, I don't know what grades are. Instead of beating on that child, say, did you do your best? How can I help you? Do you know that you're still valued in my arms? You know? How about when your spouse gets a speeding ticket? Not that I've ever had one. Instead of pounding on you, my husband did. Just say, well, you know, that's the one you got. All the other ones don't care. What about rather than cutting someone down? We looked at them as a child of God for whom Jesus came to die. That's what I do a lot when I just have a hard time loving someone. You have those people in your life you have a hard time loving. And I look at them and think, wow, they're a child of God. Jesus died for them. Rather than bullying people who are of a different opinion than ours, what if we spent time meeting with them to get to know our hearts? Not their political or social positions, but their hearts, you know? What if rather than pointing fingers, we join forces about doing good? Because I tell you what, no matter how different we are, there is some common ground in terms of being able to do good for God, spurring one another on to good works. That's what the scripture said this morning. Loving those who don't have time to blame because they're trying to feed their families. It's all about perspective, you know? Is that the way to live out gratitude? I think that's what gratitude is understanding who we are in Jesus Christ and living our lives, our attitudes, our actions, the way we treat one another in a way that reflects the gift that Jesus gave us. I think that's the way to live out gratitude. Have you ever given people a gift, someone a gift that was really valuable, and they never used it, and you were kind of hurt? Do you think God is sometimes hurt that we don't use the gift of Jesus in terms of living our lives in ways that reflect Him? Do you think that that is something that would reflect how much we appreciate God and how much we can live out our gratitude? Let me give you a tough example. How about the killings in Paris? How about the people that did those killings? I think we could probably have a conversation. We could probably have a hate conversation right now. And we could all be on the same page about how awful those people are, right? How could they possibly have done that? And because I get to leave, I'm going to tell you, they're also children of God. I don't know what made them do that. I don't know what happened in their lives that twisted them enough to strap themselves with bonds. But you know there had to be something going on. How would our understanding of Jesus' sacrifice encourage us to spur one another on to love and good works in the midst of that horrific attack? Because, you know, our faith doesn't just live itself out in the church on Sunday morning, or at work on Monday when we like everybody, or on Tuesday when we go to an office something. It's also on Friday or whenever those attacks happen, when we read the news or hear about it. What do we do then? Does our gratitude get reflected in our attitude toward them? Or do we just immediately go to hate? Have those attacks changed your perspective on the things you're complaining about? You know, there's construction on 74 on the way over here. When are they ever going to get that done? You know, when are they ever going to slow me down? I have to change the speed limit. I have to da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And people were blown up in Paris. Does it change your perspective just a little bit? So when we try to find meaning in mutual hate for the shooters and the bombers, is that what we do? Because we can come together in that. We can come together in how awful those were and how awful the people are. And we can go further and say, and we hate ISIS. And what they do is awful. I am not minimizing this, all right? I'm not minimizing this. So we can go on to hate ISIS. And we can take the next tragic step and hate anyone connected with the Muslim faith. And then we can hate everyone from the Middle East. You see how bad this can get? And before long, we hate everybody that looks different than ourselves. And we hate anybody who may be carrying a gun. Or we hate anybody who speaks with an accent. Or we, you know what I mean? That hate can go on and on and on. Where do we stop turning our fear into hate and recognize that Jesus gave his sacrifice once and it was enough? And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Don't you think we need encouragement? Don't you think we need encouragement more than hate talk? Don't you think we need encouragement more than thinking about all those other little things that are wrong in our lives? Gratitude is so much deeper than a prepositional phrase about something that follows it. Was that gift of Jesus enough for you? If so, then maybe we live out that gratitude. We live the gratitude, not just say the gratitude, you know? Saying the words are nice, but we live it by the way we treat other people. Is Jesus enough for you? Let's pray. Oh, Jesus, our hearts are heavy when we see what's happening, not just in Paris, but in Afghanistan, in Israel, in New York City, in Bloomington Normal, in Champaign, Urbana, when people are hurting, when they beat each other, when children are starving. All kinds of things are going on, God. And we hurt, but we also are grateful because you sent your Son for us so that we could have forgiveness, so that we could have life, so that we could be free in you. And so, God, we claim that gift that you gave us. And we pray that we will live our lives as examples of gratitude, not just saying the words, but examples of gratitude. Thank you for your Son, Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. There are a few groups, I was going to say there are no groups, but there might be, so I don't know, who express gratitude so fully as United Methodist women. And so I would like to invite that person, those persons, to live out that gratitude.
On behalf of United Methodist Women, we want to welcome you to our main offering worship service. We extend an especially warm welcome to Reverend Debbie Reese. We are delighted that you are here sharing your worship with us this morning.
Today, we want to take a few moments to tell you about our mission work. As United Methodist Women, we are connected through faith with women in our community and around the world. As we give thanks for our many blessings, we work together to relieve suffering and seek to bring about God's plan for peace and justice for women, children, and youth. This morning, we will highlight for you three United Methodist Women mission projects that focus on the needs of children.
United Methodist Women provide funding to Global Health Action in order to provide life-saving health services to newborns and their mothers. GHA trains matrons or birth attendants in safe birthing practices. The matrons assist with home births, often in homes with dirt floors located in isolated mountain communities in Haiti.
Some 10,000 people live in poverty among the tombs and crypts in Manila's Little Cemetery. The children of the cemetery are stigmatized by their living conditions and often drop out of school at an early age. They can be found roaming the streets selling flowers or cigarettes. Programs supported by United Methodist Women provide cemetery children a safe refuge, a hearty breakfast, classrooms, teachers, and skills training so that they might aspire to something other than landing on the tomb.
Cunningham Children's Home in Urbana is a national mission institution of United Methodist Women. So also is the Leslie Bates Davis Neighborhood House in Eastwood, St. Louis. Its mission is to empower individuals and families to move out of poverty, to achieve self-sufficiency, and to help assure that children have the community support they need to be successful in school and in life.
The state budget crisis is having a devastating impact on children and families, including those served at Leslie Bates Davis Neighborhood House, where hundreds of children participate in after-school activities through the Teen Reach program. However, in April, the Department of Human Services suspended funding of Teen Reach and Community Youth Services at Leslie Bates. Also suspended were assistance programs for children with autism and epilepsy. Not suspended are the ongoing needs of children.
In 1881, a $5 gold piece dropped into a collection plate in Lansing, Michigan by a grateful woman marked the beginning of what is now called World Bank Offering. Today, we invite you to embrace God's vision of a more peaceful and just world by making an above and beyond gift of thanksgiving in support of missions worldwide. You'll find a special offering envelope in your bulletin. On behalf of United Methodist Women and the countless women and children who receive God's blessing from your gifts,
by the way, we also want to say thanks to all of you who donated and shopped at our bazaar last weekend, and call your attention to the remaining items on our gift convention center.
Thank you. They say a lot.
Thank you. Amen.